Welcome to the Moms Making Six Figures podcast, where it's all about real women, real stories, real inspiration. And now your host and creator of Moms Making Six Figures, Heidi Bartolotta.
Hello, I'm here today with Wendy, and you have been in real estate for 16 plus years as a broker.
That's true. You're
very successful.
Yeah.
I guess I'll start out with, what did you do prior? What led you into real estate? I should add, you're a mom of 7 children.
Yes.
3 that you actually gave birth to.
That's true. 4 so you have, that just came along.
You have a very, very, very full life.
Yes, yeah. Very much so.
Yeah.
But real estate, I literally got into by accident, without a doubt. I was actually in the middle of a divorce. And at the time, interest rates were very different than what we see now. My interest rate was like 9%. I couldn't afford the payment on my own. So I had to refinance. Within that process, I ended up talking to the builder that had originally built the house. We just were conversating about the situation. And he said, hey, have you ever thought about being a real estate agent? And I said, is it full time and how much does it pay?
Right.
Because I have got to figure some stuff out with me and my single mom life here. And he laughed and kind of took me under his wing and said, I can't get you a job, but I can get you an interview. Interviewed with 3 agents that were starting their own brokerage and became their assistant. So that's kind of how real estate started. Before that, I had been working at Hewlett-Packard in different types of administrative roles.
Mm-hmm.
I worked in the call center for a while, just kind of learning that corporate world environment.
Mm-hmm.
So then switching to real estate was like an entirely different culture.
Right.
I had never really been around a lot of sales up until then. So it was a very big turn of events.
Well, and so different going from a corporate environment to more of an entrepreneurial environment. But even if you're working for someone in an entrepreneurial environment, it's different, right?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, I bet you learned a lot of lessons early on.
Yeah. I always tell people this, especially other agents that come to me with questions. You know, they talk about, well, how did you first get started in real estate? And I said, well, my first 18 months look very different than yours ever will. They had their own brokerage. So I had to learn not just about sales and real estate, but luckily I had a graphic design degree because I did all of their marketing materials. Mm. You know, I did all of the accounts payable, accounts receivable. I learned about ledger cards. I had to take all the broker classes before I was ever a licensed agent to understand what it was that I was supposed to be looking for, auditing files. I mean, it was literally a different world that I had jumped into.
Well, I feel like you got like a crash course in business.
Yes, yeah. Very much yeah. So.
And probably served you in a huge way when you moved into your own brokerage,
yes.
Right? I would imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It changed everything about the way that I think I would have been. I don't know that I would have been as successful as I have been had I not had that great foundational knowledge.
Mm-hmm. So what would you say? Obviously, real estate is one of those things that I think, especially as women, I think every single one of us has thought, oh, maybe I should go into real estate.
Yeah.
And then you look at the stats on how many are actually successful.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit of an eye opener, I will say.
Yeah.
What would you say to that? You know, our audience is a lot of aspiring six-figure earners, right?
Right.
And you're in that multiple six-figure category. If you were looking at a woman that's contemplating real estate, what advice would you give?
I think the most important thing is that you really have to know what you want and what your why is for why you're doing this, because this job is so hard.
Mm-hmm.
It is very grinding in the way of You know, you can't be afraid of rejection. You mm-hmm. can't be timid to ask. You can't be timid to have conversations. I literally have conversations with everyone in the grocery store. You know, I don't know how to not talk to people at this point mm-hmm. about any random thing, which is a little awkward in the current times, but I still do it. It doesn't seem to matter.
Not if you have a mask on.
Right. I still seem to have conversations with just about everyone. But I think that is probably the one thing that I find when I'm talking to new agents. They're just like, well, what do you even say
to people? Just stick a sign in a yard and sell a house?
Right, right. There is definitely a lot of grind behind the scenes. People mm-hmm. think I'm, you know, out and about all the time. I spend way more time marketing and doing calls and things like that from my desk than I ever do standing in front of a client. Mm-hmm. There is so much research that has to be done. I think I talk a lot about, the being a lawyer on television, for example, you see them in the courtroom, but that's literally like a tenth
of their
life, of mm-hmm. their career. And real estate is very much the same way. Yes, I'm out there showing houses or taking listing agreements or whatever, but a lot of that time is sitting and doing research, making phone calls, trying to figure out, you know, mm-hmm. what are the water rights? Do we have artesian wells? Do we have, you know, like there's so many different things that you have to consider when you're taking care of usually people's most expensive purchase that they're ever going to make in their life.
And super emotional.
Big. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you think that your stint in the corporate environment, do you think that gave you any, and the answer could be no, but I always like to ask, you know, what you did before you moved into what you're doing now. Do you think that gave you any foundation? Do you think that there were things that you learned there that really helped you as you moved into a more entrepreneurial environment?
Yeah, absolutely. I think number one thing that I learned, especially from my call center days, was customer service. The mm-hmm. way that you talk to and treat other people, mm-hmm. everyone has questions. Everyone is looking for something in their life. All you have to do is find out what that is in order to have a conversation. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times, you know, I was on the phone with a client. There's a dead time where I'm waiting for something to come up, you know, on the screen or what have you. And I always took that opportunity to smile and ask them something personal about themselves. And so I think that experience in a call center completely transformed the way that I speak to people.
That's such a great lesson.
Yeah.
Because one of the things that I always tell people is, I feel like you can hear when people are smiling.
Yeah.
You really do sense it differently, right?
But absolutely.
How interesting, because I would think that most people would say, oh, call center. Like, I was happy to get out of there. But one of the lessons that I have learned in interviewing all of these amazing women is that I think one of the biggest skill sets that I see in women that are successful is they take the things that others might seem as negative or a failure, and they always learn from it. They always end up pulling some lesson out of it.
Yeah.
That it's a different mindset, right?
It absolutely is. I even specifically remember and think about this to this day. They had us during training, we had a clip-on mirror onto our monitor, and we were actually taught to smile in the mirror when we answered the phone. So that was one of the things that really made that stick in my head. So I'm always, even now, you know, I think about, I gotta smile when
that's
I'm getting on the phone.
So intelligent.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Because it does make a difference, and it does translate for sure. That mm-hmm. that welcoming friendliness, I think, absolutely comes across on mm-hmm. the phone.
So I have a couple questions that I ask all of my interviewees, and here's one that: do you remember when you hit six figures, and do you remember emotionally as a woman what that felt like?
Oh, I do. I remember, as a matter of fact, mine came in a very unique way. I had only been selling, so I had spent almost 2 years on the admin side of the business, mm-hmm. got my license, started actually selling. It was barely about 6 or 7 months into selling. Mm-hmm. I had been blessed enough to know a lot of farmers in the area. I had one in particular who had decided decided that they were getting out of farming, going to sell their farm. Mm. So I had a big piece of land that he trusted me with. Knowing I was greener than green, he still said, I trust you. I know that That's you will awesome. Work hard for this. I know that you'll do your research and do your best job for me. So he trusted me with that and ended up letting me sell that piece of land. I connected with a developer through that piece of land and then three others that followed right afterward.
Wow.
That I listed. And in that one sale was $108,000 commission. So I hit it in an instant.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so overwhelming. I couldn't even believe that something like that was possible. I had been working for $12 an hour, $13 an hour for years in the corporate environment.
Uh-huh.
It was literally life-changing.
Yeah. That's such an interesting perspective, right? Because for most people, it's more of a build.
Sure. Yeah. Absolutely.
It's not like you're here and woo, now you're way over here.
Yeah.
So that shift, what did that shift do for you mentally? Because that had to have been, it had to play some games with you.
Yeah, it definitely did. But it the one thing that it did for me that I will never forget is I realized what was possible.
Yep.
In that instant, I was like, mm-hmm. this is a life that I can build.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's a one-time event. I knew it was a one-time event, mm-hmm. and I was going to have to continue to work to make more happen. And I got to experience the build later, mm-hmm. because shortly after that, the market tanked. We went into the Great Recession.
It's like, here's the reality.
Right. Like, just so you know, money doesn't rain off the trees like this usually. So squirrel it away, and we're going to do it the real way. So I did get to experience that mm-hmm. as well. So learning what is possible, though, I think really gave me the confidence mm-hmm. to continue to move forward, even when it got really, really hard.
Such a huge lesson. Honestly, we should like teach a course on that, because
yeah.
I think that power of possibility is, I know for me, for years, that's what drove me,
yeah.
right? And when you've seen it, when you've grasped it like you did early on, I mean, it's such a huge thing. I want that for women sometimes.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll look at them and be like, I just want you to believe it's possible for you, right?
I know. And it's so interesting because I'm not sure how to give that to mm-hmm. someone. That belief, that vision that you know in your gut.
Mm-hmm.
Because I never doubted it. Never again. I
yeah.
never once doubted it was possible again.
And you watch it turn on for people. It's a really, really cool and very powerful thing.
Yeah.
So you made a huge sale. And I think there's a lot of people that in that scenario would probably go buy the expensive car or buy the expensive purses and then just kind of assume that it was going to happen for them
yeah.
again, right?
Yeah.
Did you make that mistake?
I did. I absolutely did. I had never, like, I hadn't seen that much money in a 5-year period, much less in one moment. But it happened right before Christmas, so I spoiled my children rotten. Everyone got new furniture. We moved into a new house. Literally did all the things that you should never do. I did put some of it away. I squirreled about a third of it away, but 2/3 of it I literally blew in less than 6 months. So I got to have that experience. I think, you know, everybody does that at least once. You blow things that, mm-hmm. that you don't normally do. But I definitely learned some valuable lessons for that. Because I bought that house and all of those things happened at the very end of 2006.
Mm.
Well, 2007 is when the recession hit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So my whole entire life changed yet again. And I had to learn the importance of my acorns and the importance of striving every day to keep mm-hmm. going. I would say probably the most painful part of that was not understanding what was happening in 2007, mm-hmm. not being able to get my feet underneath me. Mm-hmm. And so that was definitely a struggle. But I just firmly still believed once it happened, it would happen again. And in 2008, I sold another big property.
So do you think that it inspired you to have the work ethic to create
yes.
that? Because what I hear is, okay, you know, I made a mistake. I learned from it. But a lot of times what will happen is people almost shut down in it
yeah.
instead of, okay, what can I do? So the work ethic came
yes.
out for you.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, your work ethic that had been there the whole time just
yeah.
really spun up. Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, and I can definitely say that work ethic was something that I have always had,
mm-hmm.
Even in college. So I really wanted to get things going. I ended up quitting high school, getting my GED so I could start college right away,
mm-hmm.
And was taking between 20 and 24 credits a semester, really trying to
wow.
push through and getting it done, and ended up graduating college when I was 19. So that work ethic has been something that has been with me pretty much my whole life.
Yeah. One of the quotes that I love is, you can always outwork the other person.
Yes.
And I think sometimes I look at people and they're like, I want this. And I'm like, it's work ethic. Like, you can outwork everyone if you want to.
Right? Absolutely.
Yeah. I say that to my kids a lot too.
Yeah.
Which like, I'm sure they don't appreciate at the time.
No. The kids never appreciate our best quotes, right?
Yeah. So let's talk about that for a second. You have a lot of children. To
yeah.
me, it's a lot of children because I have two. So
right.
seven just sounds completely overwhelming to me. But you obviously manage it very well. What is your one tip to those moms out there that maybe have three or four and, you know, they're working, they're trying to balance. What would your advice be?
Yeah. Well, I think first of all, work-life balance is something that's very, very personal. What work-life balance looks like to me may not be working for you. That may be, mm-hmm. you know, overdoing it. I get told by my friends all the time that I should rest, and I just don't think that they understand my life at all. but I think the biggest thing is that personal connection time with my kids was always something that was super important. We had daughter skip days or son skip days where I would actually pull them out of school and have some one-on-one time with me and just that one child.
Mm-hmm.
And I think those moments are the things, first of all, that they remember the most.
Mm-hmm.
And second of all, it just made sure that they always knew that they were my priority. Mom may have to work long hours. They told me all the time, the last thing I want to be is a real estate agent because I don't want to work as much as you. So they definitely got to see that.
Mm-hmm.
But they both have that. My two that have been with me the majority of my life, because some of them are stepkids and came longer, those two have the craziest work ethic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my son is an electrical engineer and super successful. He owns two duplexes at the age of 27.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my daughter is going to school full time and working a job full time. They just understand that that's what it takes if you want to succeed.
Yeah, you modeled that for them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's interesting, right?
Yeah.
I think modeling is
so important.
It's the best teacher.
It is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, another question. So, is there a book, a podcast? Is there, when you are speaking to, you know, I know that you work with a lot of younger realtors and you mentor and train. When you're speaking to someone that's younger in their career, whether it's in real estate or not, is there something that you recommend to people?
There is. It's the author is a little controversial. He's not your typical. Plus, first of all, he's a man.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the first book that I ever read on personal development. I will tell you, I absolutely lived in a victim mentality in my mm-hmm. early 20s. I didn't even know that's what it was. I had no inkling. I had never been subjected to any personal development. I didn't know what that was.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a bright yellow book that was sitting on the stand when I walked into Hastings. I don't even remember what I was doing there, but looking for something. This bright yellow book just jumped off the shelves at me, and it was called Shut Up, Stop Whining, and Get a Life. And I was like, Okay. I was so taken aback by the title. And I picked it up and I read the whole entire thing in 3 days. It literally changed who I am as a person. It was a lesson in if you don't like your life, it is your responsibility to change it. There is no white knight that's coming to save you. Mm-hmm. No one's going to make it all work for you. You have to do this. Mm-hmm. And I don't think anyone had ever told me that before.
It's interesting because being women in, in the corporate environment or in an entrepreneurial venture, which is what both of us are in, I think that that's a really bold message. Mm-hmm.
It is.
And I have to tell you, you're kind of stumped me because it's one of the first books that anyone has ever thrown at me that I haven't read yet.
Yeah.
So now I'm going to go buy it. Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Awesome.
I have extra copies. I'll just bring you one.
Okay.
I literally keep extra copies because it was such a life-changing moment. And I think if anyone can get to the point where they take 100% personal responsibility for themselves, that's where the magic is.
And it's so powerful. It's empowering. That's,
it
that's
is
so cool. So what am I not asking you?
I think the biggest thing for me in any of the lessons that I've ever learned is that 100% it is about your attitude about the circumstance. It's never, ever the circumstance. I have buried a child. I have had been through multiple divorces. I have had almost everything thrown at me in this lifetime. And I'm telling you, I am so happy and grateful for every one of those experiences because it made me who I am today. I wouldn't be able to run the business and take on employees and do all the things that I do on a regular basis had I not had the struggles that I've had. And I know that's so cliche to say, but it really is so true. And I think it 100% comes down to I choose to have a positive attitude about it. I choose to take whatever I can out of every experience and move forward.
It's so powerful and gut-wrenching. You had not told me that. One of the things that I described about you when I was talking to someone after you and I met was you can tell when someone is at peace with who they are.
Yeah.
And when people aren't, right?
Yeah.
And you definitely, in your presence, you're definitely at peace with who you are. And I love that. So you mentioned that leading up to that first major real estate sale for you, you were mainly in hourly positions that paid you hourly.
Yes.
Right? And would you say that your mindset was different when you were in those hourly roles? How did that change that drove you into this entrepreneurial role, I guess is what I'm asking, right? Because there's usually something that flips for people that's like, I can do it.
Yeah.
What was that for you?
So in looking back in hindsight, it's almost like it was laid out for me on a golden trail. So I had these hourly jobs. I end up going through this divorce. My whole life changes, everything about it. I get this job working for these other agents. It's while I'm working there that I find this book that changes everything, which then, like, it was watching my confidence get boosted over and over and over again throughout this 2 or 3 year process that really took me out of that victim mindset. I took responsibility for my actions. I took responsibility for where my life was going. Mm-hmm. That 3 year period was magic. It was the hardest 3 years I think I've ever been through, but it absolutely did change everything for me.
It's so interesting that you say that because I think, especially given where we are right now, and there are so many people that their jobs are shifting, their lives are shifting, things are definitely changing, right? And being able to look at that and almost just keep moving through it, knowing that the other side of this might be something exceptional that I never would have pushed myself towards had I not been forced to get uncomfortable, yeah. right? Because do you look back at your life and say, oh, I wish that divorce wouldn't have happened. I wanted to stay where I was.
Yeah, no, never.
Yeah.
Never once.
Yeah. yeah. And every time I ask someone that question, that's always the case. But the pain that you go through
is so bad.
To get you. and most of the time, it requires a lot of personal growth and personal yes. development, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's such a powerful lesson.
Yeah, we have an absolute question. What we ask all the time in our house is, what is this trying to teach me? Because I really don't like this. Mm-hmm. So what is it trying to teach me? Because I would like to learn the lesson as quickly as possible and move forward.
But it's such a great way to frame it.
Yeah.
Instead of, oh, why is this happening to me? It's an empowering question.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's yeah. And
so
I think
awesome.
Until people get to that point in their life where they do look at it that way, they're never going to be able to do what they're capable of.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It changes everything.
Mm-hmm. So true. So you mentioned, I feel like there was a path laid out for me. Mm-hmm. And I think we probably have a lot of listeners that are saying, I don't see a path. Like, the path isn't there. So what would you say to them? Would you say, oh, just shut down and stay where you are?
Right.
Or what would your advice be?
You know, definitely, I did not see the path when I was on it. It is only in hindsight that it has been so obvious. But I don't know that any of us can really see the path. We can see the next step. But there are a lot of people that are out there that they're not open enough to see the next step. Mm-hmm. I think you have to be curious. Curiosity is a key to anything creative or innovative mm-hmm. or movement forward. You have to really be like, that's interesting. I've never thought about that before, and move in that direction.
Mm-hmm.
Or that's so interesting. I've never tried that before. A Maya Angelou quote that I love comes to mind anytime I think about curiosity and gratitude as well. And it says, what a wonderful day. I've never seen this one before.
Mm.
And that is right in front of me every single day mm. when I get to my desk, because I want to be able to look at it with fresh eyes. It's not the same old, same old, same old. There's something new that can change everything in this day. Everything. Everything is just a decision away.
I love that. I love that curiosity piece.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for doing this with me. I so appreciate it.
Absolutely. I have enjoyed it very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Moms Making Six Figures podcast. If you enjoyed this podcast, please take a moment and leave a review on iTunes. To learn more about Moms Making Six Figures, head over to momsmakingsixfigures.com. That's right, momsmakingsixfigures.com.